straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saved. Let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, come. There will be justice, all will be new. Your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is come. God, we wait, you're coming soon. So we wait for you. God, we wait, you're coming.
God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. Amen? Can you help me say that? God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. Now let's say it like we mean it. All right? God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good.
All the time, God is good.
Hey, man, we could get stuck in that for hours. God is good all the time, and all the time, God is good. We get that stuck for hours, and it still would not be enough. Amen? We thank God for such a beautiful day. I just had to compliment God this morning that it was just beautiful. Birds singing, right? Chirping, singing. Sun is bright. It's not too hot. We got a nice breeze. Every day with Jesus is a good day. Amen? Matter of fact, anytime you don't smell roses above your head, it is a good day, and we need to thank the Lord. Amen? But even when that day comes and I do smell daisies over my head, praise God, because when I'm absent from the body, I'm going to be present with the Lord. Amen? I want to remind you, we got a normal week this week, Tuesday prayer, Wednesday new community. This Wednesday, our theme is 100-year-old day. So if you want to dress like you're 100 years old or you're a disciple or something like that, you just came off the boat of the ark, go ahead and do that. You know, we got to step our game up because Brother Levi and Brother Luke, they're like winning every week. So we need to just gang up together and come out strong. Amen?
Amen?
Wednesday for all the juniors, high school, and college, we also got our midweek service again. We're going to have a night of worship. We got some special singers coming out to help us with that. So we're very excited about that. Next Saturday, August 1st. Say August 1st.
August 1st.
Our sisters and our brethren are going to be having a production called King of Kings. Say King of Kings.
King of Kings.
They've been working so hard. They got a great production for you. And I say it's a production because it's a production. Amen. There's a difference from just showing up, and there's a difference from a production. They have worked very hard. And just like the gospel, this is free. Amen.
Amen.
So next Saturday at 6 p.m., King of Kings. The following week, we have Disciple Me, Kids Summit. Amen. Everyone say Kids Summit. August 7th and 8th, Friday, 7 p.m., Saturday, 11 a.m., free food for kids under 12. Come out, all the families come out, invite your neighbors, your relatives, your niece and nephews. Amen. Let's have a good time in the Lord. God bless you.
Praise the Lord, somebody. How many glad to be in the house of the Lord today? Come on, can we stand up on our feet? And as you stand, come on, just lift up your hands and give God some praise today. Think about where you were last week and think about all the blessings God has done in your life this week. And can we just show it right now with a lifting of our hands? Come on, that's it. With a lifting of your voice, just tell him what he really means to you. Come on, tell him how much you love him. Tell him what he means to you. Come on, that's it. Let's just create an atmosphere of praise today. Come on, we're believing God for the miraculous today. Come on, if you need something from God, just tell him what you need. Come on, it's yours. It's on the way. Come on, just give him some praise today. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Turn to somebody and say, I've come to give every praise to him today. I'll turn to the other neighbor. That was the wrong one. They didn't accept that. Come on, turn to somebody else and say, come on, I've come to give every praise to him today. Come on, that's it. Come on, put your hands together. Just worship the Lord today. Come on, that's it. Hallelujah, Lord. Oh, we come to give you all the praise. Yes, we have. Come on, you really know this song. Come on, help us sing it today. Oh, come on and say every praise.
Every praise is to our God.
Every word of worship.
Every word of worship with one accord.
Come on, somebody say every praise.
Every praise is
receive that today. Come on, somebody say every praise. Say that, come on, sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah to our God.
Glory, hallelujah.
Glory, hallelujah, is you our God.
Come on, every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise is you our God.
Come on, everybody, sing every praise.
Every praise is to our God.
Every word of worship.
Every word of worship.
God, my healing.
yes, he is. Now everybody just worship the King. Everybody lift him up right now. That's it, from the balcony to the bottom. Everybody worship your King. He's a deliverer. He's a healer. He's my Savior. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. One more time, praise him from the top of it. I'm so glad we serve him. He's a mighty God. He's a mighty God. And I want you to shout, yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
God, my Savior.
God, my Savior.
My deliverer.
God, my healer.
Oh, yes, he is.
God, my deliverer.
Yes, he is.
To praise him. I said, if you got a reason to praise him, I want you to lift him up right now. Don't let these musicians outpraise you. And if you have spiritual amnesia, I want you to think about where he brought you from. I want you to think about what he delivered you from. I want you to think about 5 years ago, 1 year ago, 10 years ago, and think about how far he's brought you from. And give him all the praise. Give him all your worship. Give him every hand clap. Give him every foot stomp. Give him every lip. I can't help it, but every time I think about everything. When I think about everything he's done for me, my soul cries out. I said my soul cries out. It cries out hallelujah. It cries out thank you Jesus. I don't give praise to the doctors. I give praise to the one who gave the doctors the ability. I don't give praise to the psychiatrist, but I give praise to the God who. You gotta know where your help comes from. Hallelujah. Come on, right where you're at, just lift up your. There's something about the name of Jesus. There's power in that name. I said there's power in that name. Sometimes we forget, we call on our friends when we're in trouble. We call on our family members when we're in trouble, but if you would just call on the name of Jesus. You won't have to wait 24 hours. You won't have to wait till the next business day. Your healing might be just in another minute. It might just be in another hand clap. It might just be in your next praise. It might just be in your next worship. Hallelujah. How do you know that God is fighting for you? I said, how many of you know God is fighting for you? If you believe that, come on, put your hands together. Let's just worship the Lord together. Come on, there's a spirit of praise in this house. Hallelujah. Come on, just magnify the Lord.
Overcome, yes, he has overcome.
said, I will live.
I will live. I will not die. The resurrection power of Christ alive in me. And I am free in Jesus' name.
Come on, let's say it again. Believe that God is fighting for you. I want you just to march like you're in the army of the Lord. Come on, that's it. Come on, say,
God is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness, lighting up the kingdom that cannot be shaken. In the name of Jesus, enemies defeated, and we will shout it out. Shout it out, come on.
God is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness, lighting up the kingdom that could not be saved.
Come on.
In the name of Jesus, enemies defeated,
and we will shout it out.
Shout it out.
Lift up the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 No weapon formed against us shall prosper. We are more than conquerors. I remember
my father was sick, which amazingly was 10 years ago. On Monday, August 3rd, it'll be 10 years. But I remember when I'd go into my father's hospital room and thinking that he would be upset, frustrated, depressed, I'd walk into the room and he'd uplift me through his strength, through his spirit, the way how he just looked at the whole situation. And I remember my father, towards the end of his days, I'm sitting at the end of his bedside, and sis, I don't know if you were there, if anybody else was there, but there was a lot of people in that room. And I remember my father lifting up his hands. And I remember him just trying to sing the best that he could, and just trying to give God praise the best that he could. Because he knew the God that we served. He understood that he could not live without him. He couldn't breathe without him. He couldn't walk. He couldn't talk. He needed Jesus in his life. And to his dying day, he looked to his help, and he gave him all the glory, all the praise, despite his circumstance. And I don't know if I... I'm encouraging somebody today, no matter what situation you're in, God hears you. God knows where you're at. God understands. And I'm a true believer that sometimes he won't allow us to come out of the situations because we need to learn something. See, it's so easy for us just to move. But when God tells us just to stand still, and I read that article Sister Kimberly wrote about her, I think it was her daughter, and her dad told her to stay there, don't move. And she didn't move because her dad told her not to move. She understood the authority and who was telling her daddy. And how many of you know that it touched me when I read that, and it kind of checked me a little bit. When God tells us to stand still and know that I'm God, why do we lean on our own ability to try to figure everything out when God says, I'm going to figure it out, but I just need you to learn something in this process? And how many know when something goes through the process, it changes us, it rearranges us, it changes the way we think, it changes the way you walk, it changes the way you talk to people. And I want God to allow me, if it's a process that I need to go through, I want God to take me through the process. Amen. And believe me, at the end of the process, God's going to break every chain. He's going to break everything that's got you bound. He's going to break everything that has control over your situation. But you've got to claim it. You've got to declare it. That there is power in the name of Jesus. Come on, lift up your hands and just magnify the Lord for just a moment. Come on, there's something special in this house today. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Come on, that's it. There is power the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There is power of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. Come on, you believe that? There is power in the name of Jesus to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Come on, help me say, there is
power.
Come on, say that.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
There is power.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
To break every chain.
Break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain.
There is power.
There is power.
Your hands and say that
there is power in the name of Jesus.
There is power.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
To break every chain.
To break every chain. Break every chain.
say that, to break every chain.
Break every chain. To break every chain.
That's it.
Break every
chain. To break every chain. To break every chain.
Break every chain. Break every chain.
Come on, somebody say, there's an army. There's an army. Come on, somebody say, I hear those chains. Come on, can you hear those chains falling? Come on, say, I hear those chains falling. Lift him up for just a moment. That's it. That's it. That's it. He's raised a standard against the enemy. He's raised a standard. Come on, that's it, cousin. Lift up your hands. It's on your game. Come on, it's on you right now in the name of Jesus. Every chain shall be broken. Every chain shall be broken. Come on, that's it. Lift him up right now. Come on, say there is power. There is power. Come on, say there is power. Your neighbor, come on, pray with your neighbor and say what you're believing God to do. I believe that everything's going to come through. God's going to answer your need. Come on, that's it. That's it. Say it's on the way. It's on the way. I hear the chains breaking. I hear it's on the way. It's on the way. Come on, that's it. Encourage one another. Jesus, that's what we call you. Yes, we do. In the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Yeah. Jesus, your name. My provider. That's what we call you, Lord. My provider. When I'm in need, Lord, you provide. My protector. You cover me. My protector. Cover my family. Cover my children. My refuge. Yes, you are. Come on. My refuge. I want you to help me say. Sing that together. Just lift up your hands. Lift up your voice. Come on, that's it. Just lift up your hands.
Praise God. Are you grateful today? Are you grateful today?
How great is our God? Sing with me, how great
is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
Come on, can we just sing that together?
Oh, how great is our God, said how great. How great is our God, is our God. Sing with me, sing with me. Is our God, and oh, how great is our God.
Come on, let's take that up one more kick.
How great is our God, is our God. Sing with me.
God, at this time, if I can have the ushers pass forward as we give back to the Lord. We give them our tithes and our offerings, and you may be seated. We are so blessed. How many are blessed? You're so blessed. A writer once said, don't ever look at what you don't have. Just be grateful and thankful for what you do have. Amen. Satan will always tell you what you don't have, but God always reminds you that he is always there for you. If I can have the ushers at this time, please. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your blessings. We thank you, God, that you continue to bless this church and to bless our provisions and our jobs. As we're grateful to give with all our hearts, God, and we give back to your kingdom. In your mighty name, we pray in Jesus' name. With this, I'm going to ask Brother Matt to continue singing the song as we pick up our offering at this time. Praise God. Give God a hand praise. Say, I thank you, God.
Amen. How many of you standing on the promises today? Amen. Come on, let's worship the Lord.
I am standing on his promises. I believe what his word says. I am standing on his promises. I believe what his word says.
I have faith
that God will do
just what he says.
I am standing on
the promises of God.
Come on, let's say that again.
I am standing on his promises.
The faith the size of a mustard seed, you can speak to the mountains in your life. Yes, you can, for nothing is impossible to them that believe. I am standing on the promises of God. Come on, somebody put your hands together.
I'm standing on his promises.
I believe
what his word says.
I am standing on
his promises.
I believe
what his word says.
I have faith.
listen. If you have the faith the size of a mustard seed, you can speak to that mountain in your life. Yes, you can. For nothing is impossible to them that believe. I'm standing on the promises of God. Anybody doing that today? Come on, I'm standing.
I'm standing on His promises.
I believe.
I believe what His word says.
I am standing on.
I'm standing on His promises.
I believe.
I believe what His
word
says.
Oh, I have faith.
I have faith.
That God,
God
will do.
Will do just what He
says. I am standing on.
I am standing on the promises of God.
Oh, if God said it. If God said it. Your hands together. Come on. If you really believe that you're standing on the promises of God, come on. I need you just to get your hands to clapping. Come on. That's it. This is the way we used to do when I was a young person. Come on. We used to get our hands put together. Come on. You got to get to moving. If you understand that God is standing on your side, come on. That's it. Yeah. Come on. Help me say. God said it.
God said it.
I believe.
I believe it.
That's good enough.
That's good enough. Oh,
God said it.
God said
it. I believe.
I believe it.
That's good enough.
That's good enough. Oh,
God said it.
God said
it. I believe.
I believe it.
That's good enough.
That's good enough. Oh,
God said it.
God said
it. I believe.
I believe it.
That's good enough.
That's good enough.
God said it.
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 I believe.
I believe.
I believe.
I believe.
I believe.
I receive.
I receive,
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 that settles,
that settles,
that settles,
that settles,
that settles.
Settles
it. God said it. God said it.
God said it.
Somebody shout, God said it.
I'm standing.
God
Receive it right now. You ought to receive it right now. Reach up and take back what the devil stole. I'm standing, not moving. I'm standing, not moving. The devil might try to shake me down. The storms might come in and try to move me around. But I'm standing on his word. Standing on his word, standing on his word, standing on his word. Come on, put your hands together as we welcome Minister Michael Thomas with us today.
Man, we don't have to stop praising him. Come on, is there anybody standing on the promises of God? Just look at a neighbor real quick and just tell them, say, neighbor, I don't know what you're standing on, but I just want to let you know that I'm standing on the promises of God. Now you can't say that if you don't really believe it. But if you know that you're standing on the promises of God, I need you to slap a neighbor high five real quick and just tell them, say, neighbor, I don't know about you, but I'm standing on the promises of God. Come on. All right. My God, come on, just for a few moments, let's give him praise all over the room. Come on, if you believe that he's working on your behalf. Come on, if you believe that he's working on your behalf. If you believe he has great things in store for you, come on and give him a praise, give him a praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Amen. Truly, we are excited to be out in the house of the Lord on this morning, this afternoon, excuse me. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Y'all just got to overlook me. I just realized, amen, I forgot my notes at home. Amen. But like Grandpa always say, amen, praise the name of the Lord. He said, any preacher that is saved and filled with the power of the Holy Ghost, he said, you always got something to preach. But I do thank God for modern technology. Somebody say modern technology. Amen. Because if you just give me about 2.8 seconds, I'm going to grab my laptop real quick. Amen. And the message that I typed up is on the laptop. Amen. I just felt the word right there. Amen. Amen. When the enemy wanna comes at you one way, amen, and he thinks that he has you captive one way, amen, God has sent in the reserve. Y'all didn't hear what I said. Amen. When the enemy think he has you captive one way, God will send in a reserve. Amen. In baseball, we call it a pinch hitter. Glory to the name of God. Amen. Truly, I'm thankful and grateful to be out in the house of the Lord on today. Amen. For there's truly no other place that I would rather be than in the house of the Lord. Amen. We do honor God and we honor, amen, the Spirit of Christ here. Amen. We thank God for Jesus. Oh, my goodness. Right. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Shout that out again, sis. I'm glad somebody with me today. Because, see, one thing you got to understand, amen, and even as I get into the message, amen, if the Lord leads me to go this direction, you'll understand, amen, just where I'm preaching from and what I'm saying on today. We got to come to a point in our life where we are more concerned about pleasing Jesus than we are about having good church. Because, see, when you begin to understand that Jesus is your main focus, a preacher doesn't have to stand in front of you, amen, and begin to remind you of the promises that God has made. Nobody has to stand in front of you, amen. I'm here to pronounce over this house that the day is over, amen, where the preacher has to be a cheerleader. Come on, somebody. The day is over where the praise and worship leader have to cheer the people into the presence of the Lord. But if grandmama was still alive, she would say, when I think back, let me calm down here. My God, I feel the power of the Holy Ghost in this place. Just go ahead and look over your shoulder real quick. And just turn back to your neighbor and say, you may not understand why I praise him the way that I do, but if I had enough time to testify and tell you about all the hell that I've been through, as a matter of fact, I don't have to go that far back. But oh, all I gotta do is just look back at yesterday when the enemy came in like a flood. Y'all just don't know, I feel like preaching today. Amen. I came out this afternoon, amen, with a purpose on my mind. Amen. To slap the enemy in his face spiritually and to give him a black eye and to let him know that Jesus is yet still on the throne. Jesus is yet still on the throne. Glory to the name of God. Jesus is yet still on the throne. Jesus is yet still on the throne. Yes, God. Let me just testify real quick, amen, and just get this out of the way, and I'll just tell it just real quick, and then I'm going to preach, amen, because I don't want any distractions in me personally, amen, to preach the word on today, amen. But I do honor God, and I do honor Pastor Ben Aguirre in his absence. Can we give God a hand praise for him? Thank God for the man of God. He's supposed to be on vacation, but I'm pretty sure, knowing Pastor Ben, that he's probably watching. Yeah. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. So just in case he's watching, just turn around to the camera and just wave at Pastor Ben. Amen. Truly, we miss him when he's not here. Amen. He is a powerful man of God. Amen. He preaches the word with power and with authority. Amen. With fear and with trembling. Amen. If you walk out of AJC and you ain't saved and you don't know Jesus, you just really don't want to know Jesus, because the word is preached, amen, with demonstration, miracle, signs, and wonders following. But I'll just be very brief, amen. Many of you know, amen, that my wife and I, we just celebrated 10 years of marriage. Praise God. Thank God for that in the month of June. Amen. And for those of you who were here at that particular celebration, we announced that we were expecting our third child. Amen. We announced that we were expecting our third child. On Thursday afternoon, amen, I got a text from my wife, and she had begun to have complications. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. And so, long story short, she went to the doctor, and the doctor told her, amen, that the baby wasn't breathing any longer, that there was no heartbeat any longer. Praise the name of God. And so, I rushed home, and I'm there in my car before I even rushed home, just trying to gather myself, because I said, God, how can I handle this? What is my response in this? And the first thing that came out of my mouth, amen, Brother Matt, the first thing that came out of my mouth was, God, no matter what happens, yet will I trust you. You know, tears in my eyes, I'm telling you, people of God. And I said, no matter what happens, God, yet will I trust you. Long story short, you know, we get a second opinion, and they confirm, you know, that the baby is no longer breathing. And so we find ourselves in the hospital on Friday night, and they have to induce my wife, amen, to cause the baby to come forth, but the baby is dead. We've been through this process before, but every time we've been through this process before, amen, I'm used to hearing a baby cry on the other end of that process. And this particular time, instead of hearing a baby cry, amen, I hear, and I can hear it even now, I hear these metal scissors that are snapping the umbilical cord, amen, and it's like a reverb was on it, and there was an echo, and I could just hear it very loud in my ear, amen. But even as I stood there and I'm rubbing my wife's head and I'm holding her hands and her hands are over her face, amen, and she just doesn't want to see what's going on. Even as I'm standing there, amen, I could still yet hear resonated down deep down in my spirit, in spite of everything that I'm dealing with right now, God, you're still good and I will yet trust you. Glory to the name of God. So It would have been easy, amen. It would have been easy, and I waited to share it today, amen, because I'm pretty sure if I would have told Pastor Ben, amen, he probably would have said, well, no, you know, don't worry about preaching. You're going through too much. But you know what? There's just something on the inside of me that just understands, amen, that when you're going through, there's two times to really praise God. The Bible says in Psalms 34, amen, that I will bless the Lord at what? See, and see, this is where we're really made. It's easy to praise God when everything is going good. I ain't gonna get no help today. It's easy to praise God, amen, when everything is working the way that you think it's supposed to work out. But what do you do, amen, when you find yourself in a situation, when you find tears, amen, running down your face, and you're trying to console your wife, and you're trying to console your children? What do you do, amen, when dreams have just literally slipped through your fingers? That is the moment when you got to lift your voice the louder, and that is the moment when you got to praise God the hardest. I don't know who I'm preaching to on today. We about to get to the word of God, but I just feel the power of the Holy Ghost in here. Because God told me a few years ago, when I first got saved, he told me, he said, son, I'm going to take you through a life of suffering. He said, but if you suffer for my name's sake, he said, then will I establish you, and I will bless you like none other. He said, you're going to live a life of suffering, but the blessings I bestow upon you are going to be for the people, and it's also going to be for you. So I begin to hear that in the back of my mind. I say, God, I'm going through this, and you're going to help me understand this by and by. But God, I'm going through this because you're allowing me to yet stand in the midst of this and tell the people of God today, no matter what you're going through, I'm standing on his promises. So I need you to just put your hand on your neighbor's shoulder real quick and tell him, no matter what you're going through, I'm standing on his promises. Amen. I hope nobody is not sad today, amen, because, you know, in the natural, amen, I may be a little bit sad, but in my spirit, man. See, you just don't understand, amen. The Bible, the song says, praise is what I do. Even when I'm going through, I've learned how to worship you. And for some of you, I'm about to be a living testimony for somebody. By the time we get through preaching today, and by the time God gets done doing what he said he's going to do, some of you are going to come out of this place. You're going to come out with a newfound power. You're going to come out with a newfound strength. And you're going to be able to say, devil, hit me with your best shot, but I will bless the Lord at all. My God, let me hurry to the word of the Lord. It is not my endeavor to be before you very long. Amen. We're going to preach the word. Amen. But truly, we thank God for the spirit of the Lord that is in this place. Amen. Glory to the name of God. If you have your Bibles, amen, or if you have your iPod or your iPad, your phone, amen, whatever you have, your Samsung Edge or whatever they call it. I'm an iPhone user, so I kind of hate on them Samsung users. Amen. So. Amen. If you have whatever you got, amen, just turn to the book of Matthew, the 7th chapter, and we're going to read at the 24th verse. Amen. We're going to read at the 24th verse. Amen. I'm truly, it's an honor. I say it all the time. Amen. It's an honor for me to stand before you and preach. Amen. Every single time I've preached here, Pastor Ben has not been here. Amen. And so that says something about the man of God. Amen. And I take this humbly. Amen. If for a pastor to be able, amen, to allow you to stand in his pulpit and he's not here, it means, amen, that he has trust and confidence in the God that's in you. Amen. So I say that humbly today, and I'm just honored to be able to stand before you. But there is a word from the Lord today. Is somebody ready to get set free today? Amen. You ready to go to another level? Amen. If you got that scripture, say amen. If you don't got it, say hold up, please. I don't think I heard any hold up pleases, amen, but we're going to go ahead and read it. It reads like this in the King James Version. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man. Somebody say wise man. Who built his house on the rock. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on the house. And it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. Let me read it out of one more translation because I like how it reads. The Message Bible says, these words I speak to you are not incidental additions for your life, homeowner improvements to your standard of living. They are foundational words, words to build a life on. If you work these words into your life, you are like a smart carpenter who built his house on the solid rock. Rain poured down, the river flooded, and a tornado hit. Man, all kind of disaster hit. But nothing, somebody shout nothing. Nothing moved that house because it was fixed on the rock. Amen. As you prepare to take your seat, amen, just look at a neighbor real quick and just tell them. Say, neighbor, no matter what comes against you, be unmovable. Yeah, look at another neighbor and say, no matter what's happening in your life, be unmovable. Amen. I'm going to preach from that topic. Amen. Unmovable. If I had a subtopic, it would be, I'm fixed on the rock. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. You may be seated in his presence. Amen. The word of the Lord is blessed. And we thank God for miracles, signs, and wonders that will follow us today because we do believe. Just look at a neighbor real quick again and tell him, say, neighbor, be unmovable. Amen. Be unmovable. Be unmovable. Be unmovable. Be unmovable. Be unmovable. Amen. Shout three times real quick. Be unmovable. Unmovable. It is interesting, amen, we find ourselves living in an hour and a moment, amen, in the body of Christ, amen, where there's so much opposition that is coming up against the body of Christ, but also there is so much opposition that is coming up against the world. Amen. We don't talk about these things negatively, amen, to give the enemy credit, amen, but just to bring to your hearing and to bring to your attention, amen, we are now living in a nation that has said that it is okay by law for a man and a man to marry and for a woman and a woman to marry. We're living in a nation, amen, where it is okay for vigilantes and for terrorist groups and organizations to set up place and to have demonstrations and to have rallies and different things in the name of freedom of speech. We are living in a nation where churches are being burned down and people are going into churches and they're killing parishioners and they're killing pastors because they have no fear of God any longer. We are living in a nation where people are walking in theaters and they're killing people simply because they don't have any purpose in their life. We are living in a nation where parents and where fathers and where mothers, amen, are drowning their children in a bathtub. You're saying, what is he talking about? Just look at the news, you know, drowning their children in a bathtub and locking their kids in closets because they said that I'm stressed out and I feel like I can't handle being a parent any longer. We, people of God, you have to hear me. We are even living in a city where a man could just walk in a house, amen, and where he could just kill another person, a woman, amen, a person that's serving the community, and he could kill children. How can you bring yourself to take a life, but let alone the life of a children? This is the type of society. This is the type of world that we're living in today. But the issue that I have is not with all the hell that's going on. The issue that I have is how quiet the church is. You see, we go to our jobs every day, and the fact of the matter is, do people really know that we serve Jesus? We talk about that we're filled with the power of the Holy Ghost, and we speak in tongues at the church. We run the aisles, we shout, and we dance, amen. We play, amen, and we dance, and we sing. But then when we get out of the church, we begin to shrink back, and we begin to shrink down, and we have given in to the talk, and we have given in to the persona that the society has put upon the church. If I was a Muslim, it would be okay for me, amen, three times a day at work to pull out my carpet and to kneel down and to pray to the God that I believe in. If I was a Hindu or if I was a monk, it would be okay for me to wear what I call my holy garments to my place of work, and people would be okay with it. But let me walk up in my job and say Jesus. Everybody begins to get nervous. Amen. Everybody begins to say, "Don't bring religion to the place of work." They begin to say, "Don't bring Jesus here. Don't bring religion here." And my response is always, "I will never bring religion to church because if you understood the Jesus that I serve, you understood it's not a religion, but it's a relationship thing. The same way that I talk to him is the same way that I talk to you. The same way that I give him the glory is the same way that I can give." Who am I talking to in this place today? You got to begin to understand that now is not the time to shrink back. Now is not the time to give up. Now is not the time to lose heart. But this is the season to be unmovable. Tap somebody and tell them, be unmovable. Be unmovable. The word of the Lord says it like this. It says, in everything, be unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. My challenge today, glory to the name of God, as it has been most of the last 2 years, as I begin to identify more with this evangelistic anointing that's on my life, my challenge is not so much for the world as much as it is for the church, because we got to begin to understand there is power living on the inside of us. We got to begin to understand that the power of the Holy Ghost is not just for good church service. The power of the Holy Ghost is not for us to feel good, but the power of the Holy Ghost is for us to walk in authority and to shift atmospheres and to change atmospheres. If I could just pull a little bit from Pastor Ben's message, he's been teaching on lion tamers, but my question today is, how many of us are still running from the lion instead of taming the lion? Yeah. How many of us walk in our house, amen, after we're hearing all of this preaching? How many of us still walk in our house fearful? Walk out in the world fearful of what's going on. This is why you got to know the word of God, because when you have the word of God, you begin to understand the heart of God. You may not be understanding what God is doing, but you can understand that his will is sovereign and that his way is perfect. The only reason I could stand before you today and not fall apart and not fall to pieces, amen, I'm not going to say I haven't cried a little bit, because I cried a whole lot of bit, praise God. I'm not going to say that I won't have some more tears coming over, amen, from days from this point. But the thing that I begin to reach down on today is I begin to look at my spiritual resume. When I was broken, didn't have a job, it was about to be evicted from my house, God stepped in right on time. When people talked about me, when they tore me down, when they wanted to kill me literally, God stepped in. Just a few months ago, when I was involved in the car accident, and when I came to, the first thing that I could remember was, thank you, Jesus. The enemy tried to kill me then. And what I understand is that come hell or high water, no matter what the test is, even what I'm going through right now, there is a testimony after the test. Who am I preaching to right now? You in one of the most difficult seasons of your life. But if you get the word of God down in your belly, the Bible says to us, I will trust not in her chariots, I will trust not in horses, but I will trust in the name of the Lord. For the name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run into it, and they are safe. Devil, hit me with your best shot. I'm safe in the will of the Lord. I dare you to take about 30 seconds and praise him for his covering. Come on, give him another praise for his protection. Give him another praise for his protection. See, this is what separates the real praiser from the arrogant believer, from the pompous believer. Because some of you sitting there looking cute, like you delivered your own self. Some of you sitting there looking cute, like you brought your own self out of the hell. But I don't care what happens, I will lift up the name of Jesus. Because God, I know there's no way I would have made it. There's no way I would have made it. There's no way I would have made it without the Lord on my side. Just shout unmovable. No, you got to shout it like you really believe it. Shout unmovable. Yeah, that's what we got to be. That's what we got to be. Glory to the name of God. We got to be unmovable. We got to be unshakable. Always ready to abound in the things of the Lord. It is interesting, because I said we are in the last days. What is the last days? Amen. 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter says, this know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful and unholy. Without natural affection, they'll be truce breakers. They'll be false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good. Despisers of those that are good. How many of us cry, amen, when get mad when people come against us in the world? You know what my response is that a sinner is going to be a sinner. They go do what they're supposed to do, but I can't handle what they do, but I can handle what I'm supposed to do. Yeah. See, the word already told me, amen, that people in the world that they're going to hate you just because you belong to Jesus. They're going to come against you just because you belong to Him. See, I'm just tagging along with what Pastor Ben has been teaching, because you got to understand Apostolic Jubilee, that this is not an ordinary church. You got to understand that we are in the middle of revival. We are in the middle of breakthrough. How is it, amen, that on last weekend, on Friday, this past Friday, over 1,400 people. Yeah, that's cute. Because, see, for us, we become so common and we become so used to stuff happening that we don't realize the miracle of what's really going on. How is it that over 1,400 people, not counting you, walked on this campus? See, what they didn't understand is that they thought that they were coming for a family fun night. They thought they were coming for some services, for a free haircut, and they thought that they were coming, you know, to have some fun, to eat some food, and you know, and things like that. But what they didn't understand is the moment you enter into the territory of Jesus Christ. My God, I don't know if y'all feel what I'm feeling. The moment you enter into the territory of the kingdom of God, that is the moment, amen, when God begins to move some things around in your life. See, the thing that we got to begin to understand is that because we've been praying on Tuesday nights and because we're in the middle of revival, every Sunday we come in this house, we don't know what God is going to do. But one thing we do know is that He's going to show up and show out. We don't know how He's going to move. Sometimes it's worship, lifting our hands high. Sometimes it's a two-step and a shout. We don't know what He's going to do. But what we know is that He's here, and God does not only dwell in the temple, but He dwells in this entire campus. So whenever a sinner enters this campus, they get gripped by the power of God. I wasn't here on Friday, but I'm sure you heard some people saying, man, this is peaceful. This is good, you know. I wasn't here. I don't know if it happened, but I'm pretty sure people were, man, this is good. You know, this feels good. Yeah. They don't know how to articulate it, but what they're feeling is the power of God in their life. What they're feeling is God moving on them. What they're feeling is God rescuing them. Why did I say that? I said all of that to say this, is that we cannot let go of what God is doing, but we gotta press in harder. We gotta push harder. We have to pray harder. We have to praise harder. We gotta fast more. We gotta consecrate more, because if God is gonna win South Modesto, it's gonna happen because you and I get on fire for Him. So perilous times. They're here. We're in the last days. Perilous times are here, and perilous just simply means hard to take and hard to bear, troublesome, dangerous, harsh, savage. It comes from the word, from two Greek words. One of the words is heleo, and it means to loosen or to slacken or to relax or to come down from a higher place to a lower place. Here's my question. This wasn't in my notes, but the Lord just gave this to me. Here's my question. If a sinner in the world is already in a low place, then how can perilous times be talking about the world? Let that sink. If perilous times is talking about the condition of the sinner, how can you come from a low place to a lower place? But it says that this word comes from a word in the Greek that means to come from a high place to a lower place, to slack up, to loosen up, or to get relaxed. This word perilous is not so much for the world. Paul, amen, was not writing this epistle to the world. He was writing it to the church. He was writing it to Timothy, amen, the bishop of this area. He was writing it to him to tell him, in the last days, the church will become lackadaisical. In the last days, the standard of holiness will be lifted from high to low. In the last days, people of God will begin to just take anything. Yeah. See, man, this is messing some of us up. This is why I done lost half of my church. It's messing us up. Because you want me to preach and to talk about the homosexual being a homosexual and the thief being a thief and a robber being a robber, and you want me to ridicule them and you want me to curse them and to preach fire and brimstone down on them. Listen, I don't need to do that, because if they don't get Jesus, if they don't get Jesus for themselves, in hell they will lift up their eyes. But I'm here to preach to those of us that are in the church, those of us that call ourselves holy, those of us that call ourselves saved and washed by the blood of Jesus Christ, those of us that say we speak in tongues, but we're still living a double standard. Those of us that speak in tongues, quote unquote, but we don't like to worship God. Those of us that quote unquote clap our hands and we dance, but we don't like the person we're sitting next to. No, I'm coming down your road today, because the Bible says, when I come back to the church, will I come back to a church that has faith? I'm here to let somebody know today that if you want to be in a church that's weak, you're in the wrong church. If you want to be in a church that's lackadaisical, you're in the wrong church. If you want to be in a church that means holiness or hell, you're in the right church. I'm here to preach to somebody today. It's time to lift the standard of holiness from the gutter, of being walked on and trampled on, not by the world, but by the church. It is time to lift the holiness standard back up to where it belongs. Baby, I'm here to let you know, God will never stoop down and bless something that's a mess. But he will only bless something that's worth being blessed. The reason why you're going through everything that you're going through is because God is trying to get the glory out of your life. So it comes from this word perilous. Comes from this word lax, you know. Just letting everything happen. My God. Yeah, this is why people frown up, amen. I don't know why am I staying here, but this is why people frown up when we teach against sin and we preach against sin. It's because for the last 20 years or so, not every church, but the body of Christ as a whole, for the last 20 years ago, have not been preaching enough of holiness and righteousness. We've been in this prosperity movement. But the moment, amen, the economy takes a nosedive, amen, people don't know what they're supposed to do, because they don't have the money. What in the world are you talking about? I'm closing down my church because I don't have the money to run programs that I used to run. I mean, the devil is a lie. I mean, well, what? Since when was the church built upon, amen, the programs that you have to run? The last time I checked, the church was built upon Jesus Christ himself. If I could just pause here and just take you to the scripture. He told Peter, he said, amen, you're going to go through all of these things, but what I need you to understand, Peter, is, he said, to the disciples, who do men say that I am? And they said, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, or one of the prophets. And he looked at him, he said, but who do you say that I am? Peter, with his cussing self, with his ear cutting self, with his rebellious self, amen, with his water walking self, I don't got time to deal with that. Peter, with his rambunctious attitude, he had a revelation. He said, Jesus, you are the Christ, the anointed one, the Messiah, the Yeshua. You are he who God said is and was. I feel good right there. You are the one who is the rock that is higher than me. You are the rock of ages. You are the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star, the rose of Sharon. You are Alpha and Omega. You are the beginning and the end. In other words, when he said Jesus, he encompassed everything that we we know him to be. You are the soon coming king that will return the church back to order. You are my healer. You are my deliverer. You are my need meter. You're everything I need. That was for me right there. If it wasn't for nobody else, you're everything I need and more. You're the one that wiped my tears in the midnight hour. You're the one that calms me when I'm in chaos. You're the one that rocks me when I'm in turbulent situations. God, you're everything I need. I need you to look at somebody and tell them, Jesus is everything I need and more. Peter says, you are Jesus, you are the Christ, the anointed one. He said, Peter, blessed are you, for flesh and blood have not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven gave you this revelation. He's the one that gave you this revelation. Then he goes on to say, and upon this rock, see, the Catholic Church says that the church was built upon Peter, but what they don't understand is that word Peter, when you break it down, it means little small pebble. Glory to the name of God. He wasn't saying, Peter, I'm building a rock upon you. Amen. I'm not hating on our Catholic brothers and sisters, but we just here to give them some truth and some revelation. The church wasn't built on Peter, but he said, Peter, that revelation that you said, that I am the Christ, the anointed one, upon that rock, Jesus Christ, the same stone that the builders rejected, the Bible said became the chief cornerstone. I'm here to let somebody know that when your building is about to break down, the only thing that's going to hold you together is Jesus Christ himself. He's better than crazy glue. He's better than gorilla tape. He's better, glory to the name of God, than the best thing in the world. Jesus is the best. Do I have any Jesus believers in the house? Do I have anybody that knows when you were going through all of the hell that you went through, smoking drugs, shooting stuff in your arm, depressed and suicidal, it wasn't mama that could bring you out. It wasn't that girlfriend that could bring you out. It wasn't the weed that could bring you out, but Jesus. I dare you to reach back real quick and just shout this with all your might. Say, oh, Jesus. See what happened? The moment you call Jesus, something shifts in your life. The moment you call Jesus, something happens in the atmosphere. The moment you say the name Jesus, glory to God. The songwriter got moved and said, Jesus is the sweetest name I know, and he's just the same as his holy name. That is why I love him so, for Jesus is the sweetest. Grandmama told me, oh, how I love Jesus. They couldn't figure nothing else out to say, so they said, oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love. Why? Because he first. I'm trying to move on, but when you start talking about Jesus, man, you something just happened. Glory to the name of God. Be seated. Be seated. Let me hurry through this thing. Let me hurry through this thing. Somebody shout immovable, unmovable. Yeah, when I got Jesus on the boat with me, my God. Yeah, you know the story. Amen. Amen. I'm just preaching gospel. Is that all right? You know the story. Amen. They're on the boat. Amen. They're going across the Sea of Gennesareth and they're going to the other side. Somebody shout the other side. Yeah. Have you ever been on your way somewhere? Amen. And all of a sudden a storm just pops up. Yeah. You're in the greatest season of your life. And then all of a sudden the storm just pops up. Yeah, here I am, amen, preparing to move on next week into a better house. Somebody say better. Yeah, here I am, amen, celebrating the favor that God has given me on this new job that he's given me. Here I am celebrating the fact and blessing God for all the doors of ministry he's opening all over this state and the nation. And all of a sudden, while I'm preparing
preparing to move forward in life, amen, a storm just arises. A storm hits, a tornado comes in, and for a moment my life is on hold. What do you do when you're on your way somewhere and all of a sudden a storm hits? What do you do when you're on your way somewhere and you're planning for something and all of a sudden a storm hits? What do you do, glory to the name of God, when you're planning a marriage and the man that you're supposed to marry walks out on you? What do you do when that child that you raised in the fear of God looks you in your face and say, I don't want your God and I don't want you? What do you do when you're standing in a familiar place, in a familiar position, but instead of celebrating, now you're crying? What do you do? You got to understand that when the storm comes, Jesus is on the boat with you. See, the thing I like about Jesus being on the boat is when we get chaotic and we start, amen, get shaken and we start getting moved. This is why you got to be a worshiper. This is why you have, Pastor Ben has been teaching about it, amen. And I'm not saying this to get brownie points, but we got to hear what he's saying. This is why you have to be a worshiper. This is why you have to have a lifestyle of prayer. Because when storms hit and you don't know how to pray and you don't know how to worship, the only thing that you'll begin to do is start to be fearful. Man, if I didn't know how to worship, if I didn't know how to pray, I promise you I would have crashed my car into a building on Thursday. But when I sat down in my car, all I began to think about, glory to the name of God, peace like a river. I don't know if you know that song. Peace like a river that tendeth my way. And the storms in the rivers, they may rise like a billow. But glory to the name of God. But will I say to myself is that it is well. It is well with my soul. So when you get into those situations, you got to begin to open up your mouth and you got to begin to sing, Jesus, you're the best thing that ever happened to me. You got to begin to sing, Lord, I'll trust you when I can't trace you. I'll trust you when I can't figure out what you're doing. You know, this is why Pastor ain't standing up here. We ain't standing up here preaching just to sweat and preaching amen to get a clap and preaching to get an amen and preaching to shout, but we're trying to prepare the church for war. Let me hurry up through this thing. So, we're in the last days. And we find ourselves in a place, in a moment, where we have two choices to make. Either we succumb to the fear that's in the world, or either we stand upon the word of God. Let me give you another definition. You know, part of that word, perilous, the deeper definition, chasma, it is the meaning of a gaping hold or a big chasm, a big gulf. It's big. Perilous times. In other words, Pastor talked about it last week or the week before. The Bible says that broad is the way to destruction, but narrow is the way unto everlasting life. See, there's so much temptation in this world today, and what we have to be careful about, amen, is that we don't begin to intermingle and mix the things of this world with the things of God. Everything that looks good doesn't need to be in the house of God. Everything that sounds good doesn't need to be in your life. Everything that looks like it's packaged right doesn't mean that it's for you. But as for me in my house, we will serve the Lord. People of God, we got to begin to come to a place in our life. Amen. I'm not prophesying doom or anything like that, but we got to begin to come to a place where we make up in our mind that things are not going to get better in the world. Things will only get worse in the world. The Lord told me to tell us here today is that even though things might not get better in the world, doesn't mean that they're not getting better in you. Yeah, y'all missed a good place to shout right there. Because, see, what you got to understand is that Psalms 91 says it in around the 12th verse. Though 1,000 may fall at my side and 10,000 at my right hand, none of it shall come nigh my dwelling. Why? Because I dwell in the secret place of the Most High, and I abide under the shadow of the Almighty. What you got to understand is that the world might be going to hell in a handbasket right now. Chaos may be all around us, but the Bible tells us that we need to begin to arise and realize this is our greatest hour. I need you to look somebody square in their face and tell them this is the greatest hour to be alive. Yeah, you got to understand, we got the answer to the world. We have the answer to the crisis in America. We have the answer to the crisis in the world. We have that. You must not believe me. We got the answer to everything that's going wrong. And that answer is Jesus Christ himself. You got to understand that hell may come, but I'm bringing Jesus with me. You got to understand. Hit me with your best shot. I got Jesus on my side. And many are they that are with me than those that oppose me. I need you to begin to gird up your strength and realize this is not the hour to be weak. This is not the hour to be broke back. This is not the hour to be punking around and acting like you don't have no strength. But this is the hour to get in your holy place and begin to seek the face of God and say, God, everything that's in me that's not like you, purge it out of me. I want to be clean. I want to be holy. I want to be righteous. Here I am, Lord. Here I am. Here I am. Shout to somebody, say, stay connected to God. Stay connected to God. It's interesting in 1 Corinthians, the 16th chapter. Glory to the name of God in the 8th verse. 1 Corinthians, the 16th chapter in the 8th verse. It is a very interesting account that Paul is in Ephesus. And he, just real quickly, Paul is in Ephesus. And he's writing back to Jerusalem. And he's writing back to the church. And he's telling them that I won't be back to Jerusalem for Pentecost. See, it was a custom for Paul and for any Jew to go back to their hometown of Jerusalem for Pentecost. It was a commandment for everybody to gather from all over the place for the feast of the Lord. Paul said, I can't go back to Jerusalem for Pentecost. But he said there in the 8th verse of 1 Corinthians 16, he said, I must remain here. And the reason why I must remain here until Pentecost, because there's a great opportunity here ahead of me. But there are many adversaries that oppose me. I brought that scripture out to let us know that if we remain in Pentecost, it doesn't matter what happens. See, many of us have just relegated Pentecost to a denominational belief. We just say we're Pentecostal or we're apostolic, and we leave it at that. But it's more than saying something. Now it's time for us to raise up and be it. If you got power on the inside of you, then you need to act like it. Every time a devil rises up, it's not time to flee and to run. But when the devil rises up, you got to say like Paul, I must remain right here because this is an opportunity to kill some devil. Where are my lion tamers in the house? Where are my devil chasers in the house? That said, I ain't scared of no devil. I'm not scared of no enemy. You can touch whatever you want to touch, but you can't take my anointing. You can't take my family. You can't take my God. I'm here to let somebody know today, this is the greatest hour to be alive. We are the church of the living God. We are the church of Jesus Christ, and his glory shall be revealed. Somebody shout glory. His glory shall be revealed. Let me walk through this thing here real quick. Glory to the name of God. For us to understand the statement that Jesus makes, here in the 24th verse of this 7th chapter. We got to understand a few things about this 7th chapter of Matthew. Glory to the name of God. The first point that Jesus makes, he says, do not judge, for with the same measure you judge will you also be judged. He tells the people that he's speaking to, he said, why are you concerned with the plank, or why are you concerned with the 2x4 that's in your, or excuse me, why are you concerned with the splinter or the speck that's in your brother's eye when there's a 2x4 that's in your own eye? In other words, he's saying, why are you worried about judging everybody else's sin when there's sin in your own life? The first thing he tells us is don't begin to judge. The Lord stopped by here and he told me to tell you today, the same people we judging is the same people that we used to be. This is why, glory, I can always tell somebody that doesn't recognize grace on their life. Because what you, when you recognize that you got grace on your life, you'll never fix your lips to judge somebody else. Why are you looking at the prostitute all crazy? Truth be told, glory to the name of God, you was a prostitute once before your own self. Why are you looking at the prostitute all crazy? You may not been getting money for it, but you know what you used to be. You know you were sleeping with everybody and they mama and they brother. But then we get in church and we get all cute. We put the veil on and we put the long dress on and we say, holy have I always been. No evil have I. The devil is a liar. How can you judge the crackhead when you used to smoke crack yourself? How can you judge the liar when you used to lie and you still lying right now? How can you judge the fornicator when you used to and you still? Yeah, I came to slay some devils today because God says it's time for us to wake up and begin to get on our face again and say, God, thank you for rescuing me. Now help me rescue somebody else. Yeah, just slap somebody, high five, and tell them, don't judge me, don't judge me. Yeah, I'm still in my process. God is still making me. Yeah, the process always looks messier than the finished product. He's still working on me. I may still look a mess, and I may mess up every now and then, but grace is on my life. Then he says, don't give what is holy to the dogs. Yeah, stop feeding the devil. Yeah, stop feeding him. Stop feeding him. Stop feeding him. Stop giving him, amen, time to work in your life. Stop giving him time to wreak havoc in your life. Stop giving place to the devil. Stop sleeping with him. Stop entertaining the devil. Why do we allow the devil to speak in our ears? When I was there in the hospital room and I heard those scissors clap, and like I said, it began to echo in my ear. The first thing the devil did, and he's so stupid, the first thing he did was ask me a dumb question that he already knew the answer to. He said, what you gonna do now when the thing that was promised to you is now dead? I said, what I'm gonna do? I said it in my mind. I said, what I'm gonna do is lift my hands and give God the glory. What am I gonna do? I'm still gonna preach. I'm still gonna worship. I'm gonna pray harder. I'm gonna worship harder. You can't defeat me. Greater is he that is within me. You need to touch somebody and tell them, say, greater is him that's in you than he that's in the world. What you gonna do? Yeah, I'm gonna still praise God. I'm gonna still worship. I'm not gonna call in. I'm not gonna give up. I'm not gonna give out, because I begin to say to myself, this ain't the first person it's happened to. It's happened to many people, and it won't be the last. But God, I thank you when you bring me through this. I'll have a testimony I didn't have before. Yeah, he wants us to quit, Brother Alonzo. But what he don't realize is when you got a relationship with Jesus, the word quit is not in your vocabulary. The word quit is not in your vocabulary. It's not in your vocabulary. Shout, don't quit. Third thing Jesus says in this passage, the first couple of scriptures, he says, keep asking, keep seeking, and keep knocking. We know we read that. We like that part. Asking and shall be given. Seeking ye shall find. Knocking the door shall be open. But yeah, you got to stop judging first and get your heart right. And then you can ask, and then you can seek, and you can knock, and then you shall find. Listen, God desires to provide for each and every one of us. We just have to keep prayer at the center, at the focus. I love the fact that the house is full and that there's people in the balcony, because what that says to me is that it doesn't matter, amen, if pastor's on vacation. He doesn't control when I come to church. He's not the one I'm coming to worship. And I could say this in some churches, Pastor Dan, I might get crucified if I said the pastor's not the one to worship. But I know this pastor that we serve under. He's all about Jesus. He's all about Jesus getting the glory. This is why you can't be weak walking around here. You got to understand, this is a free place to worship. This is a free place to get right. This is a free place to get delivered. Ain't nobody going to judge you here, because we all been a mess. But God. Ah, my shake. Let me hurry. Verses 15 through 23, Jesus begins to admonish the people to beware of false prophets and wolves in sheep's clothing. Can I tell you, brothers, let me speak to the brothers real quick. Let me speak to the young men real quick. Just because a girl looks cute doesn't mean, amen, that she's cute on the inside. Yeah. Just because she looks holy, oh my God, I'm about to get in trouble. Yeah, she wearing a dress, and she got her hair pinned up. She look holy. You better make sure she right. Because when you get into a situation, glory to the name of God, when you get into a situation, brothers, and this is where the real men go really stand up. When you get into a place, amen, where you don't have the answers, it is that holy woman of God that's going to speak encouraging words into your ear. In the midst of everything that we're going through, and my wife, amen, dealing with pain and all this stuff in her body, I was just honest with her. I said, you know, I don't understand this, babe. You know, I really don't. I said, you know, it's just my heart is hurting. There's a void on the inside of me. I just don't get it. She said, yeah. She said, I feel the same way that you do, babe. She said, but the same way God brought us through everything else. See, you look at me, and mind you, I can't say that. I got a cute wife and I got a godly wife. I will say that. Glory to the name of God. Yeah, she cute. She fine. She probably watching. So, baby, you cute and you fine. Amen. But I thank God that she know how to pray. Because if men really tell the truth, sometimes we act like we ain't got Jesus. Sometimes we act like we don't know what to do. But it's that wife. Thank God for a mama that prays. Grandmama used to sing, and my mother prayed for me. She had me on her mind. Took the time to pray for me. Because, see, you could be thinking you're getting a sheep and you're getting a wolf that looks like a sheep. Yeah, beware of all these people that tell you everything good that's going to happen in your life, but they don't give you a word of correction. That's a wolf in sheep clothing. If they're telling you everything is right with you, and they know that you messed up, and they know that you're crazy, glory to the name of God. Why am I going to tell you, amen, that everything about your life is right? I'm going to pull this out of my pastor's handbook. If I saw a ditch down the road, and you're walking head on to the ditch with blinders on, and I could see that you're about to walk into the ditch, would I be a good friend or man of God if I allowed you to walk and fall into the ditch? No, I'm going to go rescue you and tell you the truth. You blind and you don't know where you go. I need somebody to just thank God real quick for sound teaching and sound doctrine. Because you know, if you didn't have teaching like you get here, you would probably see. Let me move on. Let me move on. See, this is what I love about the brothers, amen, and the sisters that just came out the church. Amen. People like Brother Miguel. Amen. You talk to them, and people like Brother Carlos, amen. You talk to them, and I read their posts online on Facebook. Man, they talking about Jesus, but they still hood. They talking about Jesus. I don't mean it negatively. They talking about Jesus, amen, but they still, amen, got hood terminology. And see, many of us, amen, we look at that and we say, well, they need to hurry up and get it right. Listen, let me move on. And what you don't realize, amen, is that because they speak the language, am I right, bro? Am I right? Because they speak the language, amen, of the gangster, and they speak the language, amen, of the banger, and they speak the language of the drug dealer, because they only been knowing Jesus for a little while, but they can still identify with that world. See, you want to sit them down and tell them to get somewhere and don't do nothing, but what you don't understand is that they're the greatest. this attack against the enemy, because I know what it is to sell drugs. I know what it is to get high. So I can tell you about yourself and tell you how I did it. The biggest testimony is not those that have been holy all their lives, but it's those of us that have been messed up in a mess all over the place. Then God washed us and he cleansed us, because then the sinner can look and say, if God can do it for them. I just feel it right there. Can we just give God the praise real quick for all of South Modesto being saved? I know they don't talk like us yet. I know they don't dress like us yet. I know they don't look like us yet. But if we keep witnessing, if we keep holding up Jesus, if we keep praying, this church won't be able to hold them. Let me give you these 3 points. And I'm done here in the next couple minutes. Point number one, in Matthew 7:24, people who are fixed on Jesus and unmovable are people who hear and do. Yeah, he says, therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. You got to understand that it's not enough to come to church and just hear the word. This is the hour where we have to do the word. Somebody say, do the word. Yeah, Nike just stole the slogan, amen, from the church, just do it. Yeah, that sounds real good, and they got a check mark. Yeah, just do it. All we got to do is just do what Jesus told us to do. We can't just be hearers only, but we have to be doers of his word. Actions speak louder than words. Yeah. People, point number two, I'm going to give these to you real quick and I'm done. Point number two is, people who are fixed on Jesus and unmovable can survive anything. I might just get messed up right here, but I got one more point, so I got to keep it moving. Yeah. Yeah, it says in 25, in part A, it says, and the rain descended and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on the house. The message said, the rain poured down, the river flooded, and a tornado hit. What do you do when the tornado hits your life? What do you do when the rain pours down on you? What do you do when you find yourself in a situation? You got to understand that you were built to survive anything. I need you to look at somebody and tell them, say, neighbor, I'm a survivor. Look at them and tell them again, say, neighbor, I'm a survivor. Now just take a few seconds and tell them one thing that you survived. Come on, tell them. Come on, tell them. Maybe you ain't survived nothing. Maybe you ain't survived nothing, but I survived a whole lot of stuff. I'll just tell you this one and I'll be done. If I can grow up in East Palo Alto and stay there until I'm 20 years old, I'm a survivor. Yeah, some of y'all know where East Palo Alto is. Murder capital of the world, 3 years running. Glory to the name of God. Amen. Shooting all around us. I had to get out the classroom and I had to run down the track and jump over the fence and run home and lock myself in the house because shooting was going on all around me. Drug infested all around our neighborhood. But thank God I had a praying grandmother who said, I will not let you be a statistic of this city. I will not let you fall victim to what's going on here. But I thank God the reason why I know how to survive today is because I come from a lineage and I come from a heritage of tongue-talking, devil-slaying believers. When grandmama would go through and I would wake up at 6 o'clock in the morning, I would find her in the kitchen. I would find her speaking in tongues. I would find tears rolling down her face. Her hands lifted up. When she didn't know what she was going to put on the table, she would just begin to speak in tongues and begin to worship God and begin to go before his throne. Even when East Palo Alto was murder capital, my grandmama would still walk the neighborhood and nobody would touch her because she believed in the power of the Holy Ghost. I need you to slap 3 people a high five and tell them, I'm a survivor. Yeah, I could survive anything. But not only do I survive, I thrive. I'm not just going to survive this and stay the same, but I'm going to survive this and I'm going to get better. I'm going to survive this and get bigger. I'm going to survive this and get more in the name of Jesus. I'm going to survive this and draw closer to the Lord. I'm a survivor. I'm a survivor. My last point, people who are fixed on Jesus, they are unmovable. Yeah, 25B says, but nothing moved that house because it was fixed. I see somebody got, come on. I'm going to say that again. She helping me preach. Nothing moved that house because it was fixed. Okay, you almost got it. Nothing moved that house because it was fixed. Okay, one more time. Nothing moved that house because it was fixed. Yeah, unmovable means to be steadfast. It means to be unyielding. It means to be immobile, unmotile, irremovable, non-mobile, non-moving, unbudging. It means to be motionless, moveless, static, stationary, still, fixed, rooted, steadfast, stuck, wedged. I need somebody to shout as I get ready to get out of this place. I will not be moved. Yeah, the old song says, I shall not be moved, just like the tree that's planted by the water. I shall not be moved. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Though he come against me, yet will I give him the glory. If the enemy comes in like a flood, I need you to shout, I will not be moved. Come on, maybe you're talking to the wrong person, but look somebody in the eye and tell them, say, I will not be moved. I will be like that tree that's planted by the river of water. Come hell or high water, I will not be moved. No matter what comes and go, I will not be moved. No matter what hits my life, I will not be moved. No matter what comes my way, I will not be moved. Who am I preaching to? You need to go home and look that situation in the face and say, I am unmovable. I am always abounding. I am fixed and my mind's made up. I mean Jesus all the way. Is there anybody in this place that say, for God I live and for God I die? Blessed be the name of the Lord. Take 60 seconds and give him a praise. Come on, I'm through. Maybe you're not getting it, but I need you to take about 60 seconds and give them a praise that says, I will not be moved, and I will survive anything. I will survive anything. I will survive. Hold it real quick. There's only about four people in this house, maybe a couple more, that's praising God like you realize you survived some stuff. You sitting there acting cute, knowing that you could have lost your mind, knowing that you could have lost everything. But the fact that you're in the house of God today, I don't care what you're going through, because you made it to the house of God, I'm here to pronounce to everybody in this house, you will live and not die, and declare the works of the Lord. You will not be moved. You will not be shaken. You will not be rattled. I might bend a little bit, but I will not break. I might sway a little bit, but I won't fall over. Who am I preaching to? You will survive. We almost there. The reason why you know you can survive is because you look at other people that's surviving. Right. Is it Sister Anita, right? Arlene, thank you. Sorry, I know it was a few years ago when I came to this church to start to help out. I think I was here for about a month or so. Pastor announced in Tuesday night prayer that her husband had passed away. Unexpectedly, tragic situation. I watched this woman, however long that's been, for the last year, however long it's been, come in this church. Every time she's here, there's a smile on her face. Y'all don't think I'd be watching. And she's one of the first people to get up and to leap and to begin to praise God. She's one of the first people to get up and give God the glory. Mama Gary, how is it that you could come and still keep pouring into the young women? Amen. When the man that you loved and built ministry with for 40 plus years has gone on to meet the Lord. It's because her anchor is in Jesus. Her anchor is in Jesus. And don't let some of us lose a job. We fall apart. Don't let some of us have to eat beans and rice for 2 days in a row. We fall apart. Don't let some of us get a cut on our knee. We start falling apart. But just go to the hospital and look at those people that got their legs cut off. Go to the grave and look at all of those tombs that are there. If you can't praise God after that, then you dead already. But yet, since I have breath in my body, I will give him the glory. I will give him the praise. Why? Because I'm a survivor. Survivor. Come on, I need some survivors to just go into a fit and take about 60 seconds and give them the glory. Come on, take about 60 seconds and give them the praise. If you know you survived. Come on, I survive, I survive. I survived, I survived. I survived, I survived. I survived, I survived. I survived, I survived. I still shouldn't be here. I should be dead sleeping in my grave. I should be walking around somewhere crazy. But oh, Jesus, I thank you that I survived. Oh, Jesus, I thank you that you made a way. Oh, Jesus, you're still God and you're still on the throne. Everything I'm going through right now, I know that you'll bring me through it. I know that you'll bring me out. If you did it yesterday, you're the same God that'll do it today. I'm a survivor. I'm a survivor. I need you. I'm going to do this at the count of three. And I'm not going to tug. I'm not going to pull. But I'm going to do this real quick at the count of three. And it's going to separate the grateful from the ungrateful and from those that know that it's Jesus and not you. This is where we're going to see the real separation real quick. If you know two things, it's for two people. If you know that you survived and you know that you're not movable and it's all because of Jesus, and wait for me to count to three. When I count to three, I want you to hit this altar. I mean, run here as hard as you can and just begin to praise and begin to worship him. Here's for the next person. If you're in a situation right now when you know that this word was for you and the enemy's been trying to get you to question if you're going to make it through what you're going through right now, amen, if I could stand here and preach today, if I could stand here and still worship God today, amen, knowing what I'm dealing with in my life, the reason why I could stand here is because I know that there's still somebody out there that's worse off than me. I always tell myself that it could always be worse. If you just need, amen, just encouragement and you need, amen, just an agreement, and you need to know, amen, that you're going to survive. I need you to hit this altar. So those two people that know they're a survivor and the people that need to survive, when I count to three, see, you'll be like, amen, Brother Robert. He's just like, you know, I'm just busting out. Amen. Forget the counting to three. I'm just going to move. But at the count of three, make your way here. One, two, three. Come on, survivors. Come on, survivors. Come on, survivors. Come on, survivors. Come on, just begin to worship him. Come on, give him the glory. Give him the honor. You're still here. And it's because of the grace of God on your life. Come on, survivors. Come on, if you made it this far, I'm here to let you know that you can make it a little bit further. Come on, press in, press in. Press in. Don't wait for somebody to tell you what to do. But in your own way, you just begin to pour out to him. That's it, that's it. That's it. Let your worship rise. Let your worship rise. Come on, you won't break. You will not fall apart. Better days are ahead of you. The best is yet to come. Be thou immovable, unshakable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Come on, come on, come on, come on, survivors, survivors, survivors. Withholding of thee, withholding of thee, Lord, I surrender. Don't let your worship, don't let your worship go down. Just keep worshiping, keep worshiping. Give to you. It all over to him. Withholding nothing. Withholding nothing. Withholding nothing. Withholding nothing. Come on, just let it all go. Let it all go. Come on, just for a few more moments. Just pour out everything to him. 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 Give it all to him right now. Give him every issue. Give him every problem. Every fear, every sin. There is now, therefore, no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. I'm here to let somebody know right now, there is no mistake too big that you may have made that God can't rescue you from. He's here to rescue. He's here to restore. He's here to restore. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Yes, you are, Lord. Withholding nothing. Withholding nothing. Withholding nothing. Withholding nothing. Withholding nothing. Withholding nothing. My hope is built on nothing.